Well, good morning. It's good to see you this morning as we come together for our time of worship. I want to say a special word of welcome to you if you're our guest today. We're glad that you're here and pray that you'll feel right at home. Join in as we worship the Lord together. If you take a moment and fill out one of those communiques in your order of worship and just tear it out and drop it in the offering plate or leave it in your chair or leave it at the welcome desk, any number of options there, we would appreciate very much having a record of your visit and getting to know you a little bit better and helping you get to know Grace a little bit better, hopefully. This is a special weekend for us every year in that we celebrate on this weekend our anniversary. On November the 19th, 2006, Grace Baptist Church constituted as a Baptist church, as a church. And so every year on this weekend, we celebrate. We also have our Disciple Now, D-Now weekend with our young people. A lot of them are sitting down here, not all of them, but in their shirts, which I am sharing with them today. I don't normally wear a t-shirt to worship, but in support of our young people on this weekend, every year I do. So it kind of feels good, though, to be honest with you. I do miss my bow tie, but several of the youth and young people are wearing bow ties today, and so they're taking up the slack for me a little bit. But we are glad that you're here. Today will be a little different in that my message will be a little different than a normal message on Sunday morning in that I'm not going to be in John's Gospel as we have been for months now, but I'm going to be bringing a message specific for this anniversary weekend, so be much in prayer for that. And then as Ricky's already mentioned, I hope you come back tonight. If you're our guest, I hope you'll come back tonight. You don't have to bring any soup and a sandwich. Just come and share in fellowship with us. We've got it all ready. You could see preparatory work done out in the fellowship hall, extending out into the foyer. The walls are open and getting ready for tonight. It's always a special time, and we've always met at the Christian school on this Sunday night, but this year we get to meet in our own place. It's kind of neat. It's kind of special. So we celebrate our sixth anniversary, but our first anniversary on Oakleaf Lane, and so that just brings with it a great time of joy. Would you stand with me for our call to worship? And I just want to remind us, we're going to read it again together in a little bit. But the verse that from day one of Grace Baptist Church, it kind of became the watchword that we looked at is Psalm 115, specifically verse 1. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory. That's our desire. That's our purpose. And that's what we want this worship to be, not to us. It's not about us. It's about Him. Let's worship and glorify His name together this morning as we sing.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning.
Christ, those who are believers, with Him, but not for our own glory, but for God's glory. I don't think we could get away this Sunday without saying this passage. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to Your name give glory, for the sake of Your steadfast love and Your faithfulness. Why should the nations say, "Where is their God?" Israel, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. May the Lord give you increase, you and your children. May you be blessed by the Lord who made heaven and earth. The heavens are the Lord's heavens, but the earth He has given to the children of man. The dead do not praise the Lord, nor do any who go down into silence. Glory.
6 years ago, we gathered on a morning just like this to sign a covenant, to become a covenant church, a covenant family, covenant people called Grace Baptist Church. We did it out of a great sense of joy and a great sense of your leadership and a great sense of your presence among us. And Lord, 6 years later, we still feel that joy. We still know that presence. And Lord, we still rejoice in you and you alone. Father, during this 6 years, many folks have joined with us, signing that same covenant, becoming a part of that same covenant family, old and new, together, but not considering it old and new, but just one body, one family, one people, united in one purpose, and that is to worship and glorify you and to take your gospel to the ends of the earth. Father, it was such a clear direction by you that brought us together. And Lord, for that I am grateful this sixth anniversary. Father, we gather here not to say in Grace Baptist Church, great, because we are nothing. You are everything. We come here, Lord, not to glory in anything we have done, but as we do every Sunday, we come here to glory and rejoice in what you have done through your Son on the cross and by your Holy Spirit in binding our hearts together. Lord, we commune with you every day. But yet during the week, we have so many distractions, so many things that draw our attention away. But Lord, we bless you for this day, this Lord's Day that we meet once a week that is sacred to our souls, where we can wait upon you and be refreshed by you and be convicted by you, that you might take us forward to see more glory of yours in the world around us. Lord, we thank you for your Son. We thank you for your church. Father, we pray that through the gospel we would draw near to you and you near to us as we rejoice today in another Lord's Day. Lord, call our minds from the cares of the world. Focus, Lord, focus our minds upon you without distraction. Let our worship, O Lord, today be devout and single-minded. Let our conversation with one another this morning and then again tonight at fellowship dinner be edifying and building up of one another. Let our hearing of your word today, O Lord, be profitable, that our souls may be quickened and elevated and strengthened before you. Lord, we come into this place of worship, this house of prayer. We come, O Lord, for you to pour upon us the spirit of grace and the spirit of supplication. We are present, O Lord, in this house of praise. Awaken in us every grateful emotion, every cheerful thought of your goodness and your grace. And Lord, we are here today for instruction. Lord, give testimony to your word as it's preached today and the truth therein. Father, use it to glorify yourself in the hearts and lives of all who hear it today. Lord, may it enlighten those who are away from you. May it draw near those who, Lord, have allowed their hearts to become cold, their commitment to become lax. Lord, who have become lukewarm in their walk with you. Lord, awaken their hearts today and draw them close to you. And Lord, those who don't know you, those who've never trusted you, oh Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit today would move in their lives, in their hearts, and draw them to yourself. Father, we glory in the fact that we are weak, but you are strong. We glory in the fact that we fear many times things we ought not fear, but that your strength is our comfort, no matter what the problem. Lord, make us ready to be your people in Somerset, Kentucky, and beyond. For this is our prayer in Jesus' holy name. Amen. This last trustee meeting that I went to at Southern Seminary in October, there were two things that I just really thoroughly was ministered to by. One of them was that song. The chapel choir sang it during chapel on that Tuesday morning, and I immediately went to the director, got the name of it, got the publisher of it, and came back and said, "Bev, we got to order this and get it," and we did. And they put that together in just 3 weeks, so I appreciate the work they put in on that. Great song. The Great I Am is what our focus is. The second thing that I was ministered to by was during, of all things, a committee meeting. That doesn't usually happen, but I'm on the Boyce College committee on the Board of Trustees, and Dan DeWitt brought in a young man to just share his testimony, one of the students, with us. His name is Timur Nesbitt. Those two names don't go together, but they do now. But Timur shared his testimony. I'm not going to tell you anything else about him other than he's a boy student. And when I heard him share his testimony that morning in the committee meeting, I told him, I said, I want my Grace family to meet you. And so it just worked out perfectly. He came and led a group for DNOW with a group of our young people, young men at the Pope's house. And so I've asked him to come and just briefly share a bit of how God worked in his life through the years as a young man. So Timur, you come, my brother, and share with us. God bless you.
How y'all doing? Can you hear me well? Great. It's a joy and privilege to be with you this morning, just worshiping our Savior who died for our sins and made us alive. And so I'm like a psalmist. I feel like a psalmist when he said in Psalm 84, verse 10, for one day it's better be in your presence than 1,000 elsewhere. I don't want to be anywhere. I want to be here with you all worshiping our Savior, Lord Jesus. I'm from Kazakhstan, but I'm not from Mexico. Even I look like Mexican. Every time I go to Mexican restaurant, they speak Spanish to me. And I don't have any idea what they're saying, so I respond in Russian. And they get confused, I get confused. That's how I stop my conversation. So today, if you want to try to speak Spanish with me, I'm sorry, it's not going to work. I'm going to respond to you in Russian. No, I'm just kidding. I'm from Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan is the number 9 largest country in the world. It's a Muslim country, 60% Muslims, 43% Russian Orthodox Christianity, and then less than 2% newborn Christians. So my biological parents, they left me in a hospital when they gave birth and they left. So I became orphan for 16 years. And I went all kind of orphanages. We have a baby orphanage, we have a middle orphanage, and we have a high school orphanage. So I went all of them. And so Kazakhstan government, they came, they picked me up from hospital, and they put me in an orphanage. So when I was in a middle orphanage, there was a teacher came to me, and she told me that I have to be a Muslim because I'm born in a Muslim country. But I didn't know there was a joke. If you're born in a garage, it doesn't make you a car. And so I thought, oh, I'm born in a Muslim country, so I have to be a Muslim. So I start practicing Islam. I start going to the mosque every Friday, praying 5 times a day, and just doing religious stuff to earn my salvation to heaven. But same time, I felt that I was a slave to sin. Jesus says in John 8, if you do sin, you're a slave to it. And I was slave to sin. I was loved everything the world offered to me. And I said, give it to me. And by same time, I tried to be a good person. I feel like David did in Psalm 51, verse 3, when he says, all my sins and transgressions ever before me. And it was ever before me. And I didn't know what to do. I tried good works. It didn't help. It didn't help. And there's a one kid from different orphanage. We have two type orphanages. There's a one orphanage where good behaving kids live, and there's a one orphanage bad behaving kids live. So I was in a bad behaving orphanage. And so that kid from different orphanage, he heard the gospel through local believers, and he started sharing the gospel with the kids. And because he was not ashamed of it. And he was preaching, and teachers didn't like that. And they told him he need to stop. And he said, I can't do it because I was so amazed by this gospel. How can I stop? And so because of his disobedience, they kicked him out from that orphanage to my orphanage. I just love this providence of God. He sent his people to worse places. And so he came to my place, and he started preaching. And we as Muslims, we hated everything about Jesus. We hated everything about the cross. We hated everything about the Christianity. So what we started to do, we just started persecuting him and make fun of him. Even we were beating him for that. But really interesting that he didn't respond with love. And he never fought back and he never cursed us. So that really got me. And one time with my friends, we asked him if he want to come and there was an opportunity to steal food from cafeteria, and we asked him if he want to come and steal, and he said, I can't do that. And I told him why, and he shared with me 2 Corinthians 5:17. He says, if you in Christ, you are a new creation. The old passed away, behold, the new become. And so he said, I'm a new creation. I'm not slave to sin anymore because Christ redeemed me with his precious blood and washed all my sins away. And so I can't do what you do. That really got me. And I asked him, tell me more about this Jesus. And he started sharing the gospel with me. He said that Jesus is the creator of everything. He created everything. Based on Colossians 1:16, he says that Paul says that everything was created by him and for him. I was created for him, but our first parents, Adam and Eve, they sinned against holy God. And so, and because I was descended by them, their seed was impacted me, and so I was born in sin because of what they have done. When Paul says in Romans 3:23, we all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And so there's no way I can enjoy glory of God because sin separates me before him. And it doesn't matter how good I am and what I'm doing, it's not going to work. And so, and he was sharing this, and he said that Jesus humbled himself. He lived everything in heaven, and he became one of us. And he lived perfect life, never sinned, went to the cross, took the wrath of God upon himself, took the sin of this world upon himself, and he died. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is 2 Corinthians 5:21, when it says, God made him who had knew no sin to be a sin for us, so that in him we become the righteousness of God. Martin Luther, the great reformer, he says, the great exchange happened on the cross. He took all my sins upon himself. And if I repent and believe in him alone, he will willingly will give his righteousness. And so, an amazing thing that he didn't stay on the cross. On the third day, he rose again. And he ascended, and he's sitting at the right hand of the Father and ruling sovereignly over everything. And so, when, as a Muslim, hearing this, I was like, this is the foolish thing I ever heard. Because Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1:18, he says, the message of the cross is foolishness for those who are perishing. But for us who have been saved, it's the power of God. And so, that doesn't make sense how God comes and lives and dies on the cross. Because Muslims, they don't believe that. And so, it didn't make sense because I was not born again yet. And so, his friends, local Christians who shared the gospel with this boy, they heard their friend was kicked out from that orphanage, and they start coming to my orphanage, and they start preaching the gospel. I was like, those Christians, they just love preaching. I think because they believe the faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of Christ. And so they keep preaching, and finally, Holy Spirit, God humbled me. He broke me and opened my heart, opened to see the glory of God and see my sinfulness. First of all, I realized I'm a sinner and I deserve hell. And gospel starts with the bad news and ends with the good news. So the first thing I heard, I'm a sinner and there's no way I can pay for my sin. But there's a good news that Jesus Christ, he took punishment and he took my sins upon himself. He became sin for me. And so now, if I repent from my sins and repent from my self-righteousness, and I will be covered by his righteousness. And so I saw my sinfulness, I saw the glory of God, I saw the beautiful and ugly cross that was my Savior was hanging there, and he became a curse. Galatians 3:13 says he became a curse for me. And so, and I just put my trust in him alone, and I repented from my sins. And then God changed my life radically. And I became one of those crazy Christians like my friend did. And And so when you became a believer, you have a hunger for God's word. And so the local Christian, they gave me a Bible in Russian. And so, but I couldn't read Bible publicly because I was always surrounded by people who hate Jesus. And so what I had to do, I have to get up every midnight and go into the bathroom and read my Bible in the bathroom. And I believe bathroom is the best place to read the Bible. I still have that habit. I just love it. And so I just realized God's word is so amazing. And so it's not, it's a Bible, it's all about Jesus. In Old Testament, Jesus Christ concealed. In New Testament, Jesus Christ revealed. And so it's not only information, but transformation. And it's and so sad in America, I see a lot of people, a lot of Christians. Statistically speaking, that American Christians, they read Bible 10 minutes a day and they watch TV 4 hours. And so in my country, we want this word, and we don't have it, a full translation, full 66 books. But we do here in America, and we take for granted. We put it in a shelf and let it dust it, and I'd rather play a video game or watch a movie. And so I don't want that. I don't want that. I think this God's word helps me to kill sin, because Psalm 119 says, how can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your word. I hide your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. And so I encourage and challenge you guys, read the word. And it's all about Jesus. And I promise you, it will transform you. And so when I read the Bible, I realized that I have to reconcile with this boy that I was persecuting and making fun of. And so it was tough. And so I went and I asked him for forgiveness. And by God's grace, he forgave me. And so we became good buddies. And we had one goal based on Romans 1:16. We're not going to be ashamed of the gospel, because it's the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes. And so we started sharing the gospel with our classmates. It was tough. They make fun of us. But by God's grace, in the end, when we all graduated from orphanage, they became believers. It's just amazing, because we believe there's a power in the gospel. And so when I became a believer when I was 10, and when I turned 12, I met American couple who came to my orphanage, and they started helping my orphanage, and just physically. And I got to know, like, when you become a believer, you start loving people. I used to hate people, but now I love people, because God just changed me for the body of Christ. And so this couple, they came, and they got to know them really well. And one time they asked me if I can come one summer, spend whole summer with them instead of going to the orphan camp. So I spent whole summer with them, and in the end of summer we got together in the living room, and they asked me if I would like to be adopted. And I was like, of course I would love to be adopted. And so now I'm adopted twice, by Heavenly Father and by Earthly Father. And I don't take my parents for granted. I don't. I love them so much. And they're huge for me. God bless me with that. And I see a lot of kids in America, they take their parents for granted. They're not thankful what they have. They have I've been orphaned for 16 years. I didn't have mom and dad. But now I do. And I'm so thankful. And so I encourage kids to love their mom and dad, and be thankful that they have a roof under their head, and food to eat, and bed to sleep, clothes to wear, and they're not orphans. And so, and a lot of kids do, they just don't love their mom. So I encourage and challenge kids to give a hug to your mom and dad today. Tell them, thank you for loving me, and for caring for me, and working hard to provide. And so it's a gift from God. And so now I was adopted when I was 16 by God's grace. And so I came to America. Man, when I came to America, I'm like, this is heaven, you know. And so God just started doing a lot of things in my life. And then I felt that someone introduced me to a book by John Piper, Don't Waste Your Life. And so I started reading that book, punched me in the face. Because first when I came to America, I was like, I want to pursue American dream. And then God just changed me radically. Now, I go to Boys College. He provided me to go to Boys College, and I'm going to the Boys College to prepare, to train me theologically and biblically to go back to my country and plant the church and be a pastor and train a local pastor. So that's my passion, and I won't trade that passion with anything. I don't care if there is a persecution or suffering. I'm ready to go, because I'm so packed by the gospel, what Christ has done for me. And I want to say with Paul, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I live now, I live in the flesh by faith in the Son of God who loved me and who gave himself for me. So that verse challenges me to go and proclaim this glorious gospel, what Christ done on the cross for sinners. And I believe if in my ministry, if one sinner repents, oh, there is a million angels in heaven rejoicing. And so praise Jesus for his amazing grace. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to hear and breaks my fears. How precious dear that grace appeared, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone. Yet thought I knew the way.
Bow your heads with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, you have blessed us so abundantly with your grace, Lord, and with your salvation. God, I pray that all we have truly is Christ, Lord, and that our only hope is in you. That we'd realize the error of the race we run toward hell, Lord, and accept your call of salvation and the call you have on our lives, Lord, to turn from evil and turn to good. Turn to your light, Lord. God, I pray that you bless the offerings as they're given today, Lord, that they go to further your kingdom. And I pray that we give abundantly in the realization of the gift that you've given us and how great a salvation we've received from you. God, thank you for this wonderful weekend we've had, the wonderful weekend to learn and grow in you. Disciple now, Lord. And I pray that you bless what the students have learned and bless the leaders further, Lord, as we learn to teach your word and we learn to grow in you. And just bless the rest of this congregation, Lord, and all the people who meet in your name today, Lord, that we can go out into the world and proclaim your Son, Christ, anew with more passion and more fervor, more energy than ever before. All we have is you, God. All we have is Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I hope you can understand why I wanted Tamur to share a bit with us this morning as he has come. One thing he didn't explicitly mention, but I will explicitly mention it, because we're coming into the Lottie Moon Christmas time for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions, and that is that his parents, who are his adopted parents now, are missionaries of the International Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention. And they're the ones who went there to help with the orphanage and who met Tamur, had him in their home for a summer, and then adopted him into their family. And it's just a great story. A lot of times, you know, we give to Lottie Moon Christmas offering. We give to our regular offerings church, of which 10% goes to the cooperative program. And we think, well, we never see the results of that. Well, you've seen the results of it this morning. Just how God works, just one small way, and that's magnified hundreds of thousands of times across this world. And so Tomorrow, you were our Lottie Moon speaker today. I didn't even know it. But it just really reminds me of how good God's grace is. And I appreciate him sharing that with us. Take your Bibles and turn with me, if you will, to the book of Matthew. That sounds really strange to say this morning because we're always saying turn to the book of John. But this morning, the Gospel of Matthew. And I want us to think just a few moments about Jesus' statement here and Peter's statement here. And then we will probably also look at another passage or two. This is not the normal expository approach that we take, but it is a special day. It's hard for me to stand here and really believe that it has been 6 years since we constituted. 6 years and a month or so since we first met on that cold, dark Sunday night on October 22nd with no heat and no lights in an unfinished building at 120 Losey Street. I'll never forget standing there that night after having spent all afternoon loading up my study and with about 20 other men, packing it up and moving it out and coming together that night, tired, exhausted, wondering if 20 people might be there or 50 people or could God even bless with 100 people, and then walking in that place and seeing 250 people gathered with one idea, one thing in mind, and that was let's worship and let's move forward for the glory of God. It was the most phenomenal night I've ever been a part of. We had to put little electric heaters out that did no good whatsoever. It was just for psychological support, I suppose. We had candles everywhere. We had one light that we ran a long extension cord to another part of the building that had electricity. The room didn't have electricity. And we had one spotlight kind of spotted on the pulpit, you know. And we had a few little amplifiers plugged into a microphone and running out of the other building. And we worshiped that night. And one of the verses we looked at was Acts chapter 2, which we will get to in a moment, just kind of to tie things up together. Tonight, or this afternoon when you leave, or maybe it'll still be this morning when you leave, but when you leave after this service, as you go out, the ushers have something for you. Some of you have participated in this. They have a booklet that is entitled Stones of Remembrance. Many of you remember that a year or so ago, I asked you if you would be willing, and many of you did. All of you didn't, and that's okay. You'll wish you had after you get this, and if you want to, we'll do a supplement later on. But many of you wrote what I called a stone of remembrance based on Joshua 4:6, where Joshua said to the children of Israel, after they crossed the Jordan River, after they had entered into the promised land, he said, now go back into the river, and ahead of each tribe, pick up a stone and bring it out and build a memorial on this side. And in future years, when your children say, what mean these stones? Or what do these stones mean? You'll be able to tell them those stones are there as a remembrance of all that God did for us in bringing us out of slavery through the wilderness and into the promised land that he had promised to us. And so they had those stones of remembrance. And so what I wanted is some stones of remembrance. Some of these in here are very, more like pebbles. Okay, they're short, they're concise, they're to the point. There's two or three in here that are boulders. They're really big stones. But they all come together to help us to remember. This is really a history of Grace Baptist Church by those who were there that night and by those, many who have joined with us since then, just sharing. So there's one of these for every family. Please get one. You'll enjoy reading it. I took this to Dallas a few weeks ago to work on it, and I had sort of a rough copy that I printed out to take with me, and I shared this Wednesday night. I laid it on the dresser, and I went to do something away from the room, and Jeff was in the room, and when he came back, he was sitting over the corner, and he had the Stones of Remembrance open, and he was sitting there reading them, and tears were running down his face as he just reflected on the goodness and the grace of God on that day and on that night. So I hope you'll pick one up. I hope you'll read it. Some of it is very, very direct in some things, and that's okay. But it's all to the glory of God. And if you're here our guest, I invite you to have one and just find out a little bit more about where we came from and what we're all about. Those stones are there for you to read and for you to be able to be reminded and remind others what Grace Baptist Church is all about. Hear the word of the Lord from Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 20. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he was asking his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" In other words, "Who do people say I am?" And they said to him, "Some say you're John the Baptist, and others Elijah, still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And Jesus said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, Simon son of John, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven." Then he warned the disciples that they should tell no one that he was the Christ. In reality, this is one of the most controversial passages in all the New Testament, because it's interpreted in several different lights by different groups. One particular group, the Roman Catholics, interpret this as Peter being that rock. That Jesus said, "Peter, your confession is so great and so grand, and you have seen it so greatly that I'm going to build my church upon you." But I want you to understand that when Jesus looks at Peter and commends him for what he says, "But Peter, I want you to understand, flesh and blood, your intellect, your emotions, your own body did not reveal this to you. You didn't figure this out yourself. But my Father who is in heaven has revealed it to you." It's not Peter that is important here. It's the truth that by God's grace, Peter announces. And so I think the real test or the real truth of interpretation of this passage rests not in building a church upon Peter as a first pope, as one who will serve as the rock or the model of the church, but it's upon that confession that Jesus makes. When everybody else is wondering, when everybody else is saying, "Oh, he's a prophet, he's a great teacher, he's one who really ought to be listened to because of those kind of things," and he looks at them and he says, "Okay, all of that is fine and well, but who do you say that I am?" And Peter, bold, audacious Peter, he says, "I want you to know you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are the anointed one. You are the promised one. You are the Messiah. You're the one that is, as Timur mentioned earlier, the Old Testament was already showing forth in a very revealed, a very concealed sort of way that would ultimately be revealed in the incarnation. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You're the one we've looked for and the prophets and Moses have promised for all of these years. And Peter, I want you to know that God revealed that to you. You didn't figure it out. And upon this confession, upon this truth, I will build my church." I want you to notice Jesus will build his church. I titled this sermon, you know, the church, when Christ builds his church. We spent 2,000 years, two millennium, sometimes trying too hard to build a church. We've tried to build it. We've tried to make it what we want it to be. And because of that, you've got every sort of flavor out there that you can imagine that calls itself a church. Last week, somebody brought me an ad out of the Lexington paper. And in this ad, it was a big ad about a church, not here in Somerset, but in a very close proximity to here. And they were having a big announcement that on, I think it's February the something, or maybe it's January, they're having a Las Vegas night with friends. It's a fundraiser. And they said gaming will begin and go from 6 till midnight. And we'll have roulette and blackjack and craps and Texas Hold'em and all these names of different gambling games. And it says at 8 o'clock, the Las Vegas show will begin featuring Donny Osmond. And this is a church doing what the world does best, but not what the church is called to do. Jesus said, it's upon this confession that I will build my church. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are the Christ. You are the Messiah. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are what matters. You are the great I Am that the choir sang about this morning. You are the one who has come down out of heaven, perfect God, holy God, taken on flesh, and now is God-man dwelling among us. You are the one who is going to take away the sin of the world. You are the one who is going to bring new life to those who believe. You are the one who has been promised for generation after generation, and we believe that you are Him. In our generation, if you look around, you can go into church after church after church and many times not even hear the name Jesus mentioned. That's tragic. That's why that 6 years ago when we formulated and we came together by God's grace and we believe in obedience to God, we made several commitments. One is that what we do in this building will be only to His glory. It'll be worship. Worship and the Word is what will take place in here. Not a lot of recognition. Not a lot of saying, "Oh, good job, well done, you're a good person." It's just glorifying God, exalting the cross of Jesus Christ, and as that song we sang this morning said, "I will boast only in Him and in His cross." We made the commitment that we were going to be simple church. You've heard that banded around, and we still want to bant that around a bit because, quite honestly, I'll be honest, you know, just to be truthful here, since moving to Oakleaf Lane, it's kind of become a little more difficult to be simple church. You know, when we met in what was basically a warehouse, it was, and when we had to go for our adult classes up and down Bogle Street in doctor's office waiting rooms, and when we had the children meeting in rooms not a whole lot bigger than this pulpit up in the other side of the sanctuary building, I mean, it was easy to say, "Hey, we're just simple church." But you know, I still want to be simple church. Because simple church focuses on that one thing. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Not to us, O Lord. Not to us, but to Your name be all the glory. Lord, make us a simple body of believers who don't look out for what we can get or how we can feel unless it's feeling Your presence and walking in Your presence. Out of that simple church concept, we kind of built three ideas, or we probably stole these somewhere, but that's okay. Borrowed them. And that is, it'd be three elements of this simple church concept. It's on your bulletin every Sunday. I don't know if you ever read it or not. It's on your bulletin today, right under all the announcements. This week at a glance, down at the very bottom, it says our purpose. Our purpose is loving God, loving one another, and reaching the world. Loving God, we want to guide believers to grow in their love of God. We want to help you see God in all His glory and love Him all the more. We want to do that in the Sunday school classes. We want to do that in Bible conferences. We want to do that when we meet for worship in here. We want to say, listen, this is what really matters. Until you love God with all your heart, soul, and strength. Until you really love Christ above all the other idols that demand our attention in our world today. Until you really fall in love with Christ and fall in love with God, you might as well forget loving one another. You might as well, other than those who are just like you, you might as well forget loving and reaching the world with the gospel. Loving God. Loving God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, your might, your intellect, your emotions, your being, your life. Loving God. That's why we move through the Scriptures expositorially, because we believe there's not just a story there, but there's truth there that builds our lives and strengthens us to see Him all the more glorious. 2 weeks ago, the last time we were in John, We were in John, the last part of chapter 6. We saw a similar confession of Peter. If you remember, when Jesus turned around, all these superfluous disciples that had been following, all these just kind of, you know, liked the food and they liked the miracles and they thought it was fun and games. And Jesus turned around to the 12 that were with him and said, "Well, now, are you two going to leave me?" And Peter's confession there, different from this confession, a different place altogether. But Peter's confession there was, "Lord, where are we going to go? To whom shall we go? You're the one who has the words of life. Who do we go to? Where do we go? You're our hope. You're our strength. You're our life. To whom shall we go?" We carefully chose the songs to sing today. "Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone." We sang that night on October the 22nd together. And we wept as we sang it, but we recognized that it was His grace that was doing and bringing us together. "All I have is Christ." Because we have to come to that place in loving God to say, you know, the stock market may crash tomorrow. I may lose my job tomorrow. This country is in a mess, to say the least. And we are now a nation that has clearly gone on record as saying we support death and killing of babies. We support the destruction of marriage from God's perspective. We support much that God stands against. We're on record as saying that, folks. If we don't come to realize that all we have is Christ, that there's no human Messiah, there's no politician, there's no Supreme Court, there's no government that can save us. All I have is Christ. But that's all I need. That's all I need. All I have is Christ. Loving God, seeing Him as all I have. And we sang that great hymn to begin with. I requested that. "Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me." There's one thing we've seen in 6 years. He's a faithful God. Just in being here. I mean, just in His provision. And listen, if you're new here or you're a guest here, and I know you don't know the story, and I don't have time to recount it this morning, but let me have a chance to tell you about God's provision of this facility. It was not man's doing. It was God's doing. That we could even be here. We ought to be over there on Losey Street for at least another 10 years if we're going to do it. But we trusted Him to do it. And great is His faithfulness. Loving God. Loving one another. Loving one another. Jesus said, "It's by this that all men will know that you're my disciples, if you have love one for another." I appreciated last night at the D-Now service that Clay dealt with that a bit. It's not about this kind of general, "Oh, I love everybody." No, it's loving your brothers and sisters in Christ in a unique and a special way whereby the world looks at it and says, "I don't understand that." Like Timur talked about, going back to one who had shared the gospel with him, whom he had persecuted and whom he had ridiculed and even physically harmed, and saying, "Will you forgive me? I'm your brother in Christ. I love you." And seeing that forgiveness. "By this all men will know that you're my disciples if you have love one for another." It's not the bumper stickers. It's not the crosses around your neck. It's the love that you have for His body. The love that you have for His people. And we're to love the world in the sense of taking the gospel to them. That'll come next. But the primary love is that we love God first. Then we love one another. And that means more than just saying, "Hey, I love you." That means knowing something about one another. That means knowing where we're hurting and caring for one another and ministering to one another. I've said it before. Real love is not saying it. Real love is showing it. Real love is living it. Real love is seeing a brother or sister grieving and grieving with them, or laughing and laughing with them, or seeing them with a need and having the ability to meet that need and meeting that need with them and for them as God directs. That's real love. We love one another. love one another. We want to just guide you to love God. We want to guide you to love other believers, and to care for one another. And then the third part of that purpose, part of that simple church, is reaching the world. To guide believers to reach out to the world with the truth of the gospel. Starting here in Somerset. With your neighbors. With your relatives. With those who are the hardest to share the gospel with. You know, it's easy to get on an airplane and go to Peru. And we do that. And some of you may challenge the concept that that's easy. If you spend a week in the Chancay River Valley, but it's a little tough in some ways, but that's easy. You can go in there and you can tell those people about the gospel. You can tell them about how much Jesus loves them. You can tell them how much Jesus has done for your life, and then they won't see you at least for another year, probably, unless you go on multiple teams. That's easy. It's harder to tell someone that knows you and knows you well that Jesus is all you need. And Jesus is all you want. And Jesus is everything to you. Jesus has changed your life. Jesus has made you a new creature. Because they see you. They know what's important in your life. But Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says, "Upon that rock, I will build my church." One other passage. Just one other. I've got five others, but we'll just do one other. Acts chapter 2. Turn there with me. This plays right into that statement. This is right after Pentecost. You remember Pentecost? Peter stands up and he preaches that sermon on that day, and he quotes the Old Testament, and he says, you've killed him. You've killed the Lord of glory. He declared to them the truth of the gospel. You remember that? He said, "Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know, this man, delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death, but God raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it is impossible for him to be held by its power." Then he quotes David. And then 3,000 people are saved. 3,000 people are baptized. The church begins to explode. And then they start meeting in homes. They go to the synagogue typically, and they listen and they share with people what God has done in their life. You find Paul still going to synagogues to proclaim the gospel. But I want you to hear what happened after all that happened. Down in verse 40 of chapter 2. And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, "Be saved from this perverse generation." That's a cry we need to be making today, because we live in a perverse generation. "Be saved from this perverse generation." So then, those who had received his word were baptized, and that day there were added about 3,000 souls. Now listen at verse 42. It's what Luke does many times in writing Acts. It's sort of a summary verse. It's a transitional verse. And he says, "And they," that is those 3,000 that were saved along with the apostles, "they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer." Four things they were doing continually. And they were devoting themselves to it. You know what that word devoting means? It means they were committed to it above everything else. It means they did it no matter what else called for their attention. They were devoted to this. They were committed to this. He says they were continually devoting themselves first to the apostles' teaching. Now, we don't have any apostles around anymore. They died off. I know you'll hear people call themselves apostles, but if you read the text, what the requirements of apostle are, they saw the ministry of the Lord, they saw the resurrection with their own eyes, they were present there. There are no more apostles around, I'm sorry. But we do have the apostles' teaching in this book. We have what they taught. We have what by the Holy Spirit they have given us to understand. And we ought to be in the same way that they were listening to John and Peter and Paul and Matthew and all the others. As they were hanging on every word of what they said verbally to them, we ought to be hanging on every word of what their teaching is today through our understanding of the Word, our study of the Word, our being absorbed in the Word. They continually devote themselves to the apostles' teaching. Secondly, to fellowship. Now, I know we think of fellowship as just food. Tonight, we're going to have fellowship with our soup and sandwich banquet. Do it every year, and it will be great fellowship. But let me tell you something. We're not coming to eat the soup and the sandwiches. We're coming to celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ and His goodness and His grace and His provision. Oh, somebody'd say amen to that. Thank you. Thank you. I mean, our centrality, our shared thing, which koinonia means something shared in common, a treasure shared in common. Our treasure is not baked potato soup or vegetable soup. Or a pimento cheese sandwich, although I love those things. Our shared treasure is Jesus Christ. We're coming together tonight and we'll eat and we'll share that. We're coming together because of Christ and Christ alone. In Christ alone, which by the way we will sing in a moment. He's our hope. He's our rock. He's the focus of our fellowship. Breaking of bread, that's the Lord's table. That's observing the Lord's table, communion together. We do that once a month here. We come to this table. We observe the Lord's Supper. But that is beyond just breaking of the bread in the actual supper. It's worshiping together. And again, that's what we want to do in here. We want to just worship and rejoice in His grace and His goodness. And finally, to prayer. You know, nothing got us through 6 years ago like prayer did. We prayed together in small groups. We prayed together in large groups. We were on our faces before God. We were begging God and pleading with God for His provision, and He was faithful. I'm worried just a little bit. I don't know, worry's a sin. So, confessing that right now, maybe the word I should use is just I'm concerned a little bit. We're not spending the time in prayer that we spent 6 years ago. That maybe we've kind of subconsciously think now we've got it together. There's not the animosity. There's not the struggle. There's not the lies. There's not the deception. There's not the attacks. And so we think, well, it's all gone. We've got it. We've arrived. As Timur said, he thought he got to, American thought he arrived in heaven. We sometimes think like we've got to heaven because we've got to grace. Folks, this could all fall apart tomorrow except by His grace. That's why we need to be on our faces before God continuously. That's why we need to be gathering. And you say, well, I pray. I pray at home. I pray at mealtimes. I say prayers. Yeah, I know. But I mean fervent, committed prayers with brothers and sisters. You know, one of the things we built in this complex is a prayer room. That you can get into 24/7. The whole building's alarmed except that room, and it's secure, but it's not alarmed. You can get a code by calling the church office. You can go in and out of there. You can pray. You can meet friends there. You can pray. And I'm And in the coming months, you're going to see an emphasis on that, and hopefully even a sign up for people just to continuously be back there praying, meeting one another, coming and going, because they're here praying for our church, for the gospel in our city, and for our nation, for the gospel to be spread abroad in our nation. We send teams to Peru. We got to send teams to America. Never has our country needed the gospel like they do now. We get mad and people say, well, we're not a Christian nation. Folks, if we're a Christian nation, we wouldn't be killing 1.5 to 2 million babies every year. If we were a Christian nation, we wouldn't be saying, we will define what marriage is. We don't care what God says it is. If we were a Christian nation, we wouldn't be doing a multitude of things that we're doing. But let me tell you something. It's not about the nation. It's about His church in the nation. It's about us being Christ's disciples, Christ's messengers, Christ's ambassadors to this nation. And we won't be well received. Later we'll get in John's Gospel to John 15. Now I got to tell you, Jesus doesn't paint a very pretty picture of true believers. He says, if they hated me, they're going to hate you. If they listen to me, they'll listen to you. But other than that, they're not going to listen. Folks, we live in a day where we as believers should be together on our faces pleading for God's grace to be spread abroad in this nation. We're quick to sing God Bless America, and I almost think God's looking down when we sing that song and saying, are you kidding me? Are you joking? There's never been a nation blessed. Even ancient Israel was not blessed with what we have. Are you kidding me? I blessed you, and you've taken your blessings, and you've turned them into idols. And we go back to that passage in 2 Chronicles. If my people, who are called by my name, not if the people outside the church, not if the world will repent, but if my people, who are called by my name, believers, Christians, will humble themselves and pray, and repent, turn from their wicked ways, turn from their idols, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. You see, healing of this land is not dependent on who's in the White House. Healing of this land is not dependent on who sits in Congress or on the bench of the Supreme Court. They're part of the problem. The healing of this land begins with churches like Grace Baptist Church, members of Grace Baptist Church, saying, Lord, here am I. Send me. That's what Isaiah said. Remember the vision? Isaiah chapter 6. Every week we want to, in our worship, as I said, we want to lift your vision of God. We want to lift how you see Him and bow before Him. And when Isaiah saw that, he was fearful. He fell on his face because he was a sinner like you are, like I am. And finally, the Lord, after cleansing his lips from a coal from the altar, and our altar is not here. Our altar is Christ Jesus at the cross. And if you've been cleansed by His work at the cross, it's the same as the analogy of Isaiah's lips being cleansed by the coal from the altar, by the angel with the tongues. Once Isaiah had been cleansed, once Isaiah had been made new, forgiven, God said, who shall we send and who will go for us? And Isaiah said, Lord, here am I. Send me. Here am I. You've done a work of grace in my life. I have repented before you. I have been cleansed. I'm your messenger. Not in my own strength, but by your grace. Here, my Lord, send me to Somerset. Send me to those high schools, those college campuses. Send me to those places of work where I go every day. Send me, Lord, as your ambassador. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your work of grace that brought about Grace Baptist Church. I thank you, Lord, that our foundation is Christ and Christ alone. And Father, it's not because we figured it out. It's because you opened our eyes, just as you did Peter. You touched our lives. You touched our hearts. Father, guard our hearts from complacency, from idolatry, from Americanism, and keep our hearts fixed on the gospel. Father, we thank you for what you have done in these past 6 years. But Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do in the next years, however it is, long, until you come again. May we be found faithful to worshiping you, sharing the gospel. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you.